evening and thank you for coming. My name is Jens Hoffmann and I'm the Deputy Director of the Jewish Museum, responsible for exhibitions and public programs. As many of you know who come here regularly, you may have noticed that we are undergoing an exciting transformation and evolution. We added a larger number of new exhibition series to our programs, as well as intensified our events here in the auditorium, often providing more contemporary perspectives on art and culture. Yet, as a museum that prides itself on how it brings together art and cultural history, on how it places that into a larger cultural context and connects that with contemporary art, we of course are always interested in re-examining the past. We of course are always interested in re-examining the past. We often do this, and we are planning to do this even more in the future by looking at our own history as an institution in our upcoming exhibitions, as well as by looking at our collection. And one of the works in the collection that most of you know is Andy Warhol's 10 portraits of Jews of the 20th century. And it brings together a variety of Jewish historical figures. And you see, for example, Sarah Bernhardt, Sigmund Freud, Albert Einstein, and then all the way over there on the right is Franz Kafka. And Franz was actually supposed to be here earlier this summer, but he wasn't able to come. He couldn't get a visa. So while I was doing research and looking at the works in our collection for possible exhibitions, I came across these portraits, and they were particularly interesting to me because the series includes some of my all-time favorite Jewish personalities. Of course, the Marx brothers right in the middle of it. And what was interesting in relation to Warhol is actually that Warhol never met any of those people. So I wanted to sort of be ahead of Andy a little bit and decided that I wanted to meet these 10 personalities. And to tell you the truth, of course, I didn't know how to do this. I was worried that maybe it would be too shallow, too sensational or spectacular, or simply too absurd to talk to dead people. And I know there's been many classic methods of how to talk to dead people. Psychic mediums, crystal balls, Ouija boards, and something that is called soul-to-soul communication online. And of course, the famous witches from the Black Forest, which I consulted, but they couldn't help me either. So none of that actually worked for me. So I had to come up with a different idea of how to do this. And I decided that I wanted to bring in experts on all of those personalities who would respond to my questions in a sort of talk show-like setting here. No funny accents, no fake noses, no costumes or wigs, perhaps some masks. So tonight, we will all meet Gertrude Stein. And she will speak through Carolyn Christov-Bakargiev. Let me quickly introduce Carolyn. Carolyn Christov-Bakargiev is a curator, an author, and she's a researcher, and she's interested in the history of the avant-garde and in contemporary art and culture. She was the artistic director of dOCUMENTA 13 from 2008 to 2012, which took place in Kassel, Germany, as well as in Alexandria, Egypt, Kabul, Afghanistan, and in Banff, Canada. Her stewardship of dOCUMENTA, which is considered one of the most significant exhibitions in the world of art, renewed one of the exhibition's primal intentions, which is to enlist culture as an agent of reconstruction, healing, and dialogue. And previously to that, Carolyn served as the artistic director of the 16th Biennial of Sydney, and she was chief curator at the Castello di Rivoli, Museum of Contemporary Art in Torino. She's currently serving as a professor in the Department of Art, Theory, and Practice at Northwestern University, as well as being the chief curator of the upcoming Istanbul Biennial in 2015. I could not imagine a world without Gertrude. She was one of the most radical literary innovators, and her writing, as you all know, broke with all the well-established forms of narrative, linear, or temporal conventions of the writing of her time. Not only has her writing influenced such remarkable writers as Ernest Hemingway, F. Scott Fitzgerald, or William C. Williams, whose mentor she was, but she turned American writing into something that it rarely was before, something inventive, radical, and way ahead of its time. Her writing presents stream of consciousness experiments, rhythmical essays, or portraits that were designed to evoke, and I'm quoting Hemingway, to evoke the excitement of pure being. It can be seen as literature's answer to cubism, as Picasso once put it.
Most recently, many of us had the opportunity to see numerous artworks collected by Gertrude and her brothers Leon and Michael in a remarkable exhibition at the Metropolitan Museum called The Steins Collect. And did they collect? And they supported some of the most avant-garde artists of their time, many of which came to visit her regularly in her Paris apartment for her weekly salons. Among them, Pablo Picasso, Paul Cézanne, Auguste Renoir, Pierre Bonnard, or Henri Matisse. And it's fair to say that few figures in the last 100 years had such a direct influence on the development of art and literature as Gertrude Stein. So with this conversation, I would like to examine Gertrude's life, her thoughts, and her ideas, as well as her personality in relation to our life today. But this time, I would like to do this with the person right here with us, responding directly to our questions and to our criticism. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank Carolyn Christov-Bakargiev for agreeing to be part of this experiment. Wish You Were Here has been funded by Lorraine and Martin Beitler, who actually originally gave us the Jewish Museum, the Andy Warhol's 10 Portraits of the Jews of the 20th Century, and who also have been so generous to support this entire series of talks. So I would like to thank them, and I would also like to thank them both for coming tonight. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank two people here at the museum, Jenna Weiss, our manager of public programs, and Dan Palmer, our assistant curator extraordinaire, who have been working very closely with me in making this happen. Our next Wish You Were Here program will take place on Thursday, March 19. Mark your calendars, and I will be talking to Sarah Bernard, who will be represented by Carol Oakman, who is a professor of art at Williams College and a Sarah Bernard scholar. We have been actually collecting questions over the last 2 weeks through our website and Twitter and Facebook, and I have some of those questions already with me, but I know that some of my colleagues are having these little note cards. You can get those note cards, write your questions for Gertrude down. I will select some of them later on to read to her. So please join me in welcoming Gertrude Stein.
Is a little figurine of yours.
Thank you, Jens.
Thank you. Thank you.
Jens, I am here.
Yeah, wait, I need to push her for the PowerPoint.
So we are all here. Are we?
Yes. I'm very happy to have you here at the Jewish Museum. It's been a long dream of me to meet you.
I'm glad to be back. It's been a long time since 1946.
So, Gertrude, let me start by asking you something that's always really puzzled me. Which, what does this mean when you say a rose is a rose is a rose is a rose? What does this mean? I mean, look at this. There's lots of roses and you in front of more roses. Please explain this.
What a question. Ha! That's a really funny question. That is like the funniest question of all, the question that you just asked, because the question is a thing in itself, isn't it? And therefore, to answer the question, I will go back to the beginning, because every question has a beginning, a middle, and an end. In the beginning,
I knew it was a complicated question.
In the beginning, I wrote Sacred Emily. It was 1913. Did I? Yes. But I wrote it. When I wrote it, I did. And I wrote color mahogany center, rose is a rose, is a rose, is a rose. Loveliness extreme, extra gaiters, loveliness extreme, sweets and ice cream, page, ages, page, ages, page, ages. But to go back to the beginning of the question and ask the question again, humming does as humming is. Next to hurry and hurry, pink coral, white coral, coral. She talks about it. I talked about it in poetry and grammar, did I not? It came out again in lectures in America. When I said, a rose is a rose is a rose is a rose. And then later made that into a ring. I made poetry. And what did I do? I caressed, caressed, completely caressed, and addressed a noun. Do you know the ring? I will show you the ring, Jens.
Please.
In my journey from 1946 here, I traveled through Evanston. And in Evanston, Chicago, Evanston, Illinois, I found my first edition. I'm so happy because I'm so famous. I find my first editions everywhere. They are everywhere. Because Alice B. Toklas wrote, she only met three geniuses in her whole entire life. One was me. The other two I've forgotten, but perhaps one was Pablo Picasso, and the other was Whitehead. Whitehead of all people, Alfred North Whitehead. I have never quoted Alfred North Whitehead in my life. Have you ever found a paper by Gertrude Stein with Alfred North Whitehead mentioned, except for the autobiography of Alice B. Toklas, where she says that in the preface? What does that tell us about William James? What does that tell us about William James? And the ring, I said, the ring of roses, the roses ring. The putting a rose is a rose is a rose is a rose was on my cover. You see the little ring?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
There it is, yeah. The ring. And then I must say something serious, because seriosity is serious and one must be serious occasionally when one is trying to answer the questions, because the questions are serious, they are crucial, they are important, they are of here, they are of now. And when I spoke, I wrote, I am going to read what I have written to read, because in a general way it is easier even if it is not better. And in a general way it is better even if it is not easier to read what has been written than to say what has not been written. Anyway, that is one way to feel about it. I was talking about the making of Americans, and I said, I began to get enormously interested in hearing how everybody said the same thing over and over again with infinite variations, but over and over again, until finally, if you listened with great intensity, you could hear it rise and fall and tell all that there was inside them, not so much by the actual words they said or the thoughts they had, but the movement of their thoughts and words, endlessly the same and endlessly different. And children, of course, they repeat. Children, this is now a little description of having loving repeating as being. This is now a little description of one having loving repeating as being. Loving repeating is one way of being. This is now a description of such being. Loving repeating is always in children. Loving repeating is a way the earth feeling. But do you want me to answer seriously?
No, I think this cleared it up for me.
Fine. I was going to tell you about William James and my studies at Harvard, at Radcliffe.
You get back to this right now. I just wanted to show you this picture here.
I can't see the picture. Oh, that's me. I was a little overweight then.
Yeah, and you
had that was early along the times, in the times, in the dark times, in the early times, in the times when my portrait was there and I was trying to look like that portrait, because I didn't like the portrait that Pablo made. I sat for him 80 times over 1905, 1906. I had just met him, actually. But I sat there and we spoke, and yet I didn't like the portrait. But he said, no worries. If you don't like it now, you will later. Or rather, did he say, it doesn't look like you today, but it will look like you.
That's good. And here you are with your brothers.
Ah, my dear, dear brothers. That was the time before I ran Leo out of the house, when Alice B. Toklas and I just couldn't take it any longer. It was 1913 or 1914, but this was before.
He moved to Italy?
He moved all over the place. Of course, he went back to Fiesole in Florence. He went actually to Settignano, near Florence, because he thought he was Bernard Berenson. Now, why would anyone want to think they're Bernard Berenson in the first place? Bernard Berenson wasn't that much of a genius. It's easy to be a genius if you're going to be looking at 14th century paintings and 15th century paintings. It's a lot harder if you're looking at the here and now, because the now are the things, the objects, the things in front of us, the things that make us what we are in the now. But Leo, dear Leo, I loved Leo. Leo and I got along. He always took care of me, and so did Michael. Michael and Leo were my brothers. I was the youngest of five, actually. But they were not all brothers. There was also a sister. But the sister and one of the brothers, we've lost him some way along the road of this story that goes through all the children of my mother and my father, Daniel, who thought we should not stay in America. We must not stay in America. As children, we must go to Vienna. We must go to Europe to study. We must go to become cultivated. And so we did. And so I studied, and so did Leo, and Leo and I loved each other very much. Leo is very important in this whole story, you know, but nonetheless, there was a time, and it has to do with Picasso, there was a time when Alice B. Toklas and Picasso and I, we couldn't take it any longer, and that was it, and Leo left, and he left with all those Renoirs.
Here's a few of the works that you...
Are we going to turn the images around for Gertrude? Gertie is here. Do you realize? You have a genius on the stage and you're putting the pictures on the back.
Have a quick peek.
I have to turn around
just
for you? I will do
this
so.
This will be the last time,
I will do
promise.
So. I will do so. I will do so now. Oh, the lovely, the pretty pictures. The wonderful pictures. The pictures that we had, the pictures that we are, the pictures that we were. Are those pictures here?
No, those are not here, unfortunately. It would be wonderful if we could have them here.
Some of them are off there.
We actually have a couple of Pablo's works downstairs in another exhibition. Anyway,
I see many stories to tell you here.
What do you think about these two ladies here, the Cohen sisters? Just as you, they're from Baltimore.
That's what I was about to say. They were
because
wealthy. I have something to tell you about the Cohen sisters.
Oh, yeah, good.
They were wealthy. They were wealthy, and they bought many of our paintings, actually.
They bought them from you?
They bought
them,
indeed. They did, indeed. But they also bought them from Pablo directly because Leo told them to buy them. There were two of them. They were sisters. They were large women. They were rich. They were very different, one from the other one. That's about it that I can say about those Baltimore girls.
Well, one of the things
I ate my Cezanne
again and again is Pablo. Pablo?
Oh, I will tell you about eating the Cezanne later then.
Yeah.
Pablo.
I have a little surprise
Pablo.
For you. Pablo's here.
Picasso.
And I will ask him to join us here on stage.
Picasso. How lovely.
Yeah. So Pablo, if you would come, now is your moment. And I think I have an extra chair here.
Pablo, how you been doing?
And I'm putting up an extra chair so he can sit right in the middle of us.
This is wonderful.
I really want to go to the bottom of all of this Pablo stuff.
Pablo, you are quite something today in your blue attire.
He changed a little bit from the beautiful image that we have here. And there's a portrait again that you don't like.
Oh, he was so handsome. Oh,
this is
that's
another
somebody
incarnation.
Else. That's somebody else. Pablo was Pablo. Hi. What have you been doing lately?
Pablo decided that he would just sit there in silence and listen.
That's fine.
And I promised him that would be fine.
That's fine.
You can have a little bit of wine though.
That's fine.
Okay, so
you
we've
want
heard
to know
about all
about
these wonderful
Pablo.
People that you've met throughout your life, and I wanted to talk to you a little bit about your salon in Paris. He is a
Picasso is a very
picture.
Important moment.
Picasso came, he
Picasso,
was around.
No, Picasso didn't come. We went out and found him. My brother Leo actually went out and found him. My brother Leo and I started buying paintings. Actually, Leo started buying paintings. I went along for the ride at the beginning. And the first paintings that we bought were not Pablo Picasso. They were, of course, artists that were much, much older than us. They were the Impressionists. They were the Cezannes. There was even a small Manet. There were a number of things. And then came, and that was 1903, because I had just gotten to Paris again. And Pablo was nowhere to be found. He had already been in Paris, of course, but Pablo was not in Paris permanently. Pablo was in Paris permanently when? In 1904? I believe in 1904. But before that, my brother Leo, who was always going to buy paintings with Ambroise Vollard, we were always there. We were always having him pull out paintings, and there came the two Cezannes. There came all those paintings, not all of them. One of the most famous paintings of our collection is not from Ambroise Vollard. We bought it straight out of the Salon d'Automne in 1905, and that was that woman by Matisse with the hat, the beautiful green and colors, and it was so natural. It was just so natural. I don't know why people wanted to scratch it in the Salon d'Automne, but everyone wanted to scratch it. Well, we wanted to buy it. We offered 400 francs. Matisse said no. We bought it for 150. He said no. We offered more, we offered less, we bought it. He came to our house. Matisse came before Pablo. Pablo came later, a few months later. My brother Leo went down the street. He found a man. The man is less known nowadays than Ambroise Vollard. And this man, who had a gallery, said, why don't you go down where the Galerie Lafayette are? There is Serrurier, and Mr. Serrurier, said Clovis Sago, has some paintings in there, some two little works by a Spaniard. And there he went, and there we had Picasso, Picasso's work, and there we went, and my brother Leo bought that damn painting with those horrible feet that you made, those feet, the young lady with the flower basket, and the feet were painted so badly, I didn't want it, Leo insisted, we had to have it, we bought it. But oh, did I change my mind. Oh, did I change my mind. I changed my mind so much. And then came all the other Picassos. And so there we are, 1905 changes everything. It's a watershed in the history of modernism, and I did it with my brother.
And not only in art, also in literature. Here's Hemingway and F. Scott Fitzgerald. I can't believe how lucky you were to meet all of those people.
Well, actually, they were lucky to meet me. I mean, to be totally honest, I threw Hemingway out. He was drunk and came into Rue de Fleurise. What did he think that was? We were doing something extremely serious.
Let me just show this clip. This is very serious. I think we all come together. Pablo's there. Ernest is there. Let's have a look.
Alice, how the hell are you? Good?
Hi.
Good. I see she's here. Follow me.
Okay. Je ne suis pas d'accord. Parce que...
This is Gil Pender, Miss Stein. He's a young American writer. I thought you two should know each other.
I'm glad you're here. You can help decide which of us is right and which of us is wrong. I was just telling Pablo that this portrait doesn't capture Adriana. It has a universality, but no objectivity.
Non, 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 vous ne le comprenez pas correctement. Vous connaissez pas Adriana. Regardez, regardez les mouvements, le tableau. C'est exactement ce qui la représente.
Non, tu n'as pas raison. Look how he's done her. Dripping with sexual innuendo, carnal to the point of smoldering. And yes, she's beautiful, but it's a subtle beauty, an implied sensuality. I mean, what is your first impression of Adriana?
Exceptionally lovely.
Belle, mais plus subtile, plus implicite, Pablo.
Yes, you're right, Miss Stein. Of course, you can see why he's lost all objectivity.
He's made a creature of Place Pigalle, a whore with volcanic appetites.
Non, non, c'est ce qu'elle est vraiment, si vous la connaissiez.
Yes, avec toi, en privé, because she's your lover. But we don't know her that way. So you make a petit bourgeois judgment and turn her into an object of pleasure. It's more like a still life than a portrait.
Non, 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 je ne suis pas d'accord.
And what's this book of yours I've been hearing about? Is this it?
Yeah, this is,
take a look. Well, have you read it, Hemingway?
No, this I leave to you. You've always been a fine judge of my work.
So here's a lady on this photograph who literally stepping into your life, and you've mentioned her already, Alice. What I find so remarkable is that you managed to live together in a time where that was not necessarily really common. Can you talk to us about your relationship with Alice? How did you meet?
It was quite a relationship. Indeed. She was wonderful. Alice B. Toklas was wonderful. She wrote her autobiography, or rather, I wrote her autobiography, as everybody knows. And that was an act of something that in later years, now that I've come back to life, I can say was feminism, because I think I invited, of course, and also invented feminism. We are the only two who could write one autobiography with two people. Two people, that's the gist of it. We were monogamous. She came in one day with friends, 1907, into Rue de Fleuris, where I had been living since 1903. And why did she come in? How did she come in? She came in because in 1906, my dear brother Michael and his wife Sally was very close to Matisse. It wasn't so Michael, that collection, that was more Sally, actually. Sally was very important in that story. Sally and Michael said, no more money for buying art. All the money we had was coming and being administered by Michael. He was our eldest brother. He was just like my father, Daniel. He was just like my father, Daniel. My father, Daniel, was just like Michael. The father, the language of the father, he was just like my father, Daniel. And Leo and I wanted to play and to repeat. And so Michael said, no more money this year. There's been a fire in San Francisco. And off he went to San Francisco. And in San Francisco, Sally brought two or three Matisses. And those were the first modernist pieces of art that ever went to the United States of America. And in San Francisco, they met Alice B. Toklas. She was from San Francisco. I was not. I was from nowhere. I have never been from anywhere. I have been born, of course. I was born in the Alleghenies. My mother, the Kaisers, they were from Baltimore. But I was, as you know, I told you already, I repeat, in Vienna, becoming cultured and automatically cultured. And then Paris, there was Paris, and then there was London, and then there was San Francisco. And so where was I from? I was from nowhere. I was a foreigner everywhere. And yet, Alice B. Toklas, she was from San Francisco. And there she came to Paris, moved in, and he moved out.
So here you are, both of you, on a ship, I suppose, traveling. Do you remember where this picture was taken?
I can't see the picture.
Okay, the other way around.
I still can't see the picture, so I can't remember the picture.
Well, anyway,
because pictures are remembered because they are objects, they are things.
Well,
but I wanted to tell you about the autobiography.
Gertrude.
This is the first edition.
Gertrude, I found something very, very interesting.
I wanted to tell you about her tenderness in Tender Buttons.
Alice wrote this.
Alice wrote this. Let's put it inside Tender Buttons. Tender Buttons is all about our relationship, you know.
That she wrote in there, then.
It's all about the red, the dripping, the red.
I wanted to offer you some, because I think marijuana has been decriminalized in, you know.
Oh, that's wonderful. Pablo, shall we have some?
I'm going to definitely eat some.
Is this an original piece of paper here of mine? Is that my handwriting?
No, this is Alice's.
No, it's Alice's.
But it's from the GS.
Take a teaspoon black peppers, one whole nutmeg, four average sticks of cinnamon, one teaspoon coriander, and pulverize into mortar. And add about a handful each of stone dates, dried figs, shelled almonds, and peanuts. Chop and mix together. This sounds like chapter 3 of Tender Buttons, which is all about food.
It's from the Herb cookbook. I don't want to
I
hold
think
you
we
up
shall
too
have
long
some.
That.
I'm going to put that down and
but
I'm going to have some.
I know our registrar go crazy that
but
the
I wasn't sitting around Paris Rue de Fleuris always drinking absinthe the way people think. We were not that decadent. We were serious. We would talk.
We would
it
drink
was
wine.
Every Saturday evening because Picasso, you started bringing friends. You wanted to see that friends would see that your paintings were near the paintings of Cézanne and Renoir. It was a generational thing because every generation is the same except for what they're looking at. It's a question of composition as explanation. So Picasso would bring his friends, Matisse would bring his friends, and there you go, all those friends I couldn't write. I couldn't get anything done, and I was trying to write 1,000 pages of the making of Americans. I was trying to write everything about everyone I had ever met in my life. So how could I write if everybody was in and out of the house and in and out of the studio looking at the paintings? So I said, enough of that. It's Saturday and that's it. Saturday night. It would start around 9 and end around 2 or 3 in the morning. That's fine because I do my writing at night. I always do my writing at night. And at dawn I sleep from dawn to 12. That's about it. In the morning, Alice, she reads what I wrote. I can listen to it. It's a second time around. I can hear the rhythm behind the words. It's not about representation, you know. But I did it before Pablo, actually. If we think about it, he was in all those strange blue and pink and thing periods, and his analytical cubism, 1909, The Making of Americans, 1906, I started. Of course, I published The Portrait of Mabel Dodge a little bit later, so my publications are a little bit later. But I basically invented all of modernism, including Picasso.
I couldn't disagree with
that. On the other hand, there is something which is something, and that something must be told as a something. One thing is color and planes on a canvas. That is the thing itself, the thing itself as you see it here and now, the different perceptions. Of course, we all come down, boil down to Bergson and to William James. He was my professor. He was not Pablo's professor. No. But William James told us everything. He was a radical empiricist, and William James said to me one day, truth is only what is has a usefulness to you, a utility to you, and that is the only truth. And secondly, you can only verify it empirically in the process of its knowing. And that tells you everything about modern art, modern thinking, modern life, the modern age, modernity, modernisms, the rose, the food, the chicken, and the buttons.
Gertrude, I have to interrupt you here to ask you something perhaps more
Pablo
serious.
Pablo is trying to say something here.
He's communicating with Jacqueline, who's over there.
But Pablo
was
great.
Since we're here at the Jewish Museum, I have to ask you this question, I'm sorry, but this is very important for us to get to the bottom of this, and I would like to know what was your relationship
with
the Germans during the years of occupation in France?
I had a feeling that question would come up. I had that feeling. That feeling was in me. I had that feeling all along. There was a beginning and a middle and an end, and we were going to end it here. I know that we were going to end it here because this is a big question. A question that is big is a bigger question than can be answered, because the question, of course, is addressed in many ways, but it is not ever resolved, because in the resolving is the positioning of the question, and therefore the question is in their beginning, in the middle, and in the end of its beginning. So I wrote what I have seen, the wars I have seen. This is my last book. I saw two wars. I saw two American armies in France. I saw the first ones, they were always drunk. I saw the second ones. The second ones, some of them went AWOL, some of them wanted to take $1,000 home. They were different. They were different because there had been the Depression. They were different. They were at my house, they came. I was happy. I was very, very happy when they came. And when they came, we opened our house and we were happy. We were in culottes. We had no food. We did not have much. I was tremendously occupied in the occupied regions of Europe, tremendously occupied with the practice of life, of potatoes and my garden, and my dear friend Bernard Failly, who had wanted to translate my works in the early 20th century, who came to Rue de Fleuris many, many times and had visited us in our country house in the 20s. Bernard Failly was very close to Maréchal Pétain. Bernard Failly wanted to help me. I have always been taken care of. I have been cared for by my brothers, by my mother, by my father. I have always been taken care of. I write, I am a writer. I am with artists. I manage, I hoe the potatoes, I wait, and the wars go by. The wars go by, and I wait. I did translate those texts. I did translate Maréchal Pétain. I did translate 32 letters, but I stopped. Did I not stop? I stopped. Were they published? They were not published. And Mr. Lansing, who interviewed me, I was ironic. Did he understand irony? No. When I said Hitler should get the Nobel Prize, Peace Prize, because he will be resolving the struggles of the world, and especially in Germany, was I sincere or was I ironic? What can you say? What can you say to Mr. Lansing? Mr. Lansing's thoughts are very limited. He was not a genius. He was not Picasso. He was not Whitehead. He was not me.
Good. So I always like to bring in current affairs, and we already spoke about the decriminalization of marijuana. And another subject that is on many people's mind these days is, and this relates very much to you and Alice, is your opinion of the changing status of same-sex marriage. And this is, by the way, a question that I got from one of our...
Does it change? Has it changed? Is it changing?
Yeah, we're in the process of changing that. I personally do not know. I like marijuana, but I'm not. Marriage is a different matter.
I cannot tell you about 2014 or 2015 because I have just appeared from 1946. I cannot tell you that. What do I say? What do I say? Our relationship was quite monogamous. Monogamous. Were we married? Were we married?
Are you married? Were you married?
Were we married? Were we married? Yeah. We were married. We were married. We were two and we were one and we were happy. And when we went to see Pablo in the south of France, we stopped along the way in a region of France right near Switzerland, and it was beautiful. It was Bilignin. It was Bilignin. It was beautiful. We got a house. We rented a house. We went there every summer. We repeated. I wrote. She read. We were together. She cooked.
So now I'm going to do something that will make you upset again, because you have to again look at the screen one more time.
Oh.
Well, since you've been such
Carl,
an excellent...
Carl, dear Carl, isn't that Carl? That's Carl's picture.
Yeah, you were quite the patriot.
Carl made the picture.
I wanted to discuss a few contemporary artists with you that we have had shows here recently in New York. And we have here Robert Gober on the left, and Jeff Koons in the center, and Chris Ofili. Picasso already shaking his head. Would those artists have made it into your collection?
Do you have any Liam Gillicks?
Unfortunately not, but I hear you. Liam Gillick would have made the sense.
Liam Gillick would have made the salon, that's for sure. Absolutely, that's for sure. Let's look at these again. Well, you know, Picasso had a way of saying, certain painters that came in, he had a certain way of saying, that's interesting. Well, what can I say? These are pretty old, aren't they? They're not exactly of the here and now. The here and now, the here and now, the now is here. This is like looking at Renoir's in 1904 or 1905. I wouldn't say it's of the here and now, so I wouldn't bring it in the Rue de Fleurus right now, would I?
Well, they've just been exhibited here, so I wanted to give you a little context of what we are looking here at New York in 2014.
Well, what can I say? What can I say? Certainly the leg is intriguing.
Okay, I bring you back to
certainly
to an era
Gober,
that you
certainly
may be
the
more
Gober.
Familiar
I
with.
Would put the Gober in Rue Christine. I would put the Gober in Rue Christine. After Rue de Fleurus, I would put it on a mirror. I put Pablo's paintings on the mirrors. It would be nice to see that leg on the mirror. Then it would be a two double mirror. It would be a double leg, wouldn't it? Two legs is a repeated leg, but a repetition with a variation is never the same. It's deeper. It's like caressing the leg.
There is another very powerful madame from Paris who made her way to New York, Elena Rubinstein. And we have her collection here at the museum right now. And there's a little image of her collection. And I was wondering if you ever actually met Elena and what you thought of her collection.
I can't remember. I met so many people. Have you read the 1,000 pages of The Making of Americans?
I would say that you probably
imagine.
Would remember her. She would have challenged you.
I can't remember. I'm sure I could remember if I tried. Did I or do I?
You were quite close with Elena Rubinstein as well. But he didn't like her as much as you did, as far as I remember, avoiding to paint her portrait for many years.
When was Helena Rubinstein born?
That's a good question. Does anybody know?
1878.
There we go, 1878.
She was my contemporary,
yeah,
wasn't
she? Yeah, that's why
she?
I thought that you guys would have met.
She was my contemporary. Did I meet her? Did I?
Yes, you did.
How interesting. Where
yes.
did I
we
meet
met her? In Paris.
Did I meet her in Paris?
Yes,
did she
yes.
come? Did
yes,
she come
and
to
you
the
were talking
Rue de
about
the
Pablo
was
of course.
Was she beautiful?
She was gorgeous.
She was gorgeous.
Yeah.
She was gorgeous,
she
and
sisters.
I talked about Picasso. Was Picasso with us?
I don't think he was around. Was no.
No. Well, I cannot help you there, my friend.
So what are you working on right now?
Well, having resuscitated in 2014, I thought I would pick up my earliest published works. My earliest published works are actually psychological test papers, papers I did in Radcliffe. No, papers I did at Baltimore. No, papers I did at Radcliffe when I was studying with William James. At the time, I was working on a number of papers, including normal motor automatism. I wrote that with a mathematician called Leon Solomons, a quite superficial, much later behaviorist psychologist called Skinner, seemed to dismiss my writings on the basis of having found my earliest papers, instead of realizing that my earliest papers were actual seminal papers to understanding what I was trying to do with language, what I was trying to do with words, what I was trying to do with distracted writing, what I was trying to do by telling those people in those psychological tests, why don't you read a book while I, on the other hand, ask you to write on a paper some doodles? And how did the doodles come? How did the doodles come? The doodles came out with words. Words appeared. Words that they were reading. Is it possible to have a split personality? Is it possible to find a normal motor automatism? And so I went back to my recent paper from 1898, which was not normal motor automation, but cultural motor automation. Cultural motor automation. I think that was the whole point of my entire oeuvre, how to let those words move freely along the page and in the sound. It's about the rhythm. It's about the caressing. It's about the rhythm and the tone in the words on the page and the words coming together because they come together in a one. In a one like Picasso. Would you like me to read you an example?
Please.
I will read you an example. Pablo, he is so charming. Shall I read you one or shall I read you two? I wrote two portraits of Picasso. I read one that nobody knows as much as the other one. The other one that everybody knows, they know also because, thank God, there is Kenneth Goldsmith. Kenneth Goldsmith, Ubu, Ubu, Ubu. Ubu has me on the web. I am super up to date. I'm on ubu.web. And on ubu.web is my portrait of Picasso if I told him. If I told him, would he like it? Would he like it if I told him? Would he like it? Would Napoleon, would he like it? If Napoleon, would he like it if I told him? Now. Exactly as kings, feeling full for it, exactitude as kings, so to beseech you as full as for it, exactly or as kings, shutters shut and open, so do queens, shutters shut and so 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 and so shutters shut and so and so and also exact resemblance to exact resemblance, the exact resembling exactly in resemblance, exactly a resemblance, exactly end resemblance. For this is so because. Now actively repeat at all. Now actively repeat at all. Now actively repeat at all. I won't read the whole portrait, but in conclusion, I wanted to tell you that all my writing is about writing. The subject of my writing is writing. The subject of art is art. That is why we are modern.
Couldn't wish for a better conclusion. Thank you so much.
Thank Gertrude. You for having me.
So as I promised you, we have a lot of questions from our visitors that we've gathered before this evening, and I think there's also some questions from the audience here. So I would like to ask you to engage with those, and I think they're going to be brought here to me from our colleagues. And I think you will continue to need your microphone for that. Would you like some more wine? So now, thank you so very much. Here's a few to start me off. If you have any more questions, please write them down on these cards. The ladies are here to collect the question. Ah, this is a wonderful one, one that I always thought about. Quiet, please. Gertrude, you have been quoted as saying, of the Museum of Modern Art, how can you be both modern and a museum? Do you still think so? And how about the Jewish Museum?
Could you repeat the question? I like repetitions.
Gertrude, you have been quoted as saying of the Museum of Modern Art, one cannot be both a museum and modern. Do you still think so?
Yes, of course I do. The museum collects the works of the past. The museum preserves the works of the past. The museum is not the muse. The muse is not in the museum. The muse is in life. The muse is in the world. The world is outside the museum. The Jewish Museum is wonderful. It is lovely, lovely like tender buttons. It is here. We are here, and therefore it is lovely.
But can we be modern and the museum at the same time?
Modern is a term I invented in the early 20th century. It is very old. It is not modern to be modern.
I'm trying to read this question here. What do you think this means? What your working method with ugly...
Virgil Thompson.
Sorry.
Ah, Virgil Thompson. Those are later years. I've forgotten.
Okay.
He was wonderful, Virgil Thompson, Carl van Vechten, the later years, those years. Those are the wonderful years. I came back to America in 1934 to give my lectures. I became famous, then I became wealthy, then I became rich. Money, there was money. First there was no money, then there was money. Virgil Thompson.
Why did you
Virgil
go to
Thompson,
medical school?
I went to medical school because it was in Baltimore. My mother's family was from Baltimore. I knew about Baltimore. Baltimore was in the South, and then there are many stories untold in a writer. There are many stories. There are stories. There are stories of my mother. There are stories of Millie, of Molly, or Millie. She suffered. She was sick. She was sick. She had cancer. She was sick. She was in pain. Many women were treated in horrible ways. Women had leeches in their vaginas. Women were bled because they were hysteric. Hysteric, am I hysteric? Did I write hysterical prose? Is my prose hysteric? Hysteric. And did I study medicine? Medicine. Did I want to know things as they are? Things, the things as they are. The things that William Carlos Williams wrote about. Those things, the things that William James wrote about. Those things. What is it enough to test the mind in labs, or did I need to know more? Did I need to touch those things, those bodies, those things? But then, of course, I flunked and failed.
Good. You spoke about feet before. Picasso's feet. The feet he painted.
These are Alice Bitoklis's shoes. I couldn't find mine from 1946.
Yeah,
I never would wear shoes
look,
like this, but they're beautiful.
For you.
They're for Alice.
So tell us, what did you dislike so much about Picasso's feet?
I was wrong. I rarely am wrong.
I wanted to say,
but I was wrong.
Yeah.
Mm. I will just tell you now how I feel about being wrong and about those feet. When I was wrong, I was wrong. Those feet...
Rarely, though.
...were fine. But I thought I was right, and yet I was wrong. Those feet were too thin. They were too 19th century realistic. They were too blue period of Picasso. They didn't look natural. They weren't natural. They weren't like the roses that the girl was holding. They were feet. They were sad feet. They were naked, sad feet. They were thin. I didn't like those feet, but I was wrong. I cannot find where I write about being wrong, because I don't like to be wrong. So I have forgotten where I wrote about being wrong. But there I was certainly wrong. Wrong I was, and that painting hung in our Rue de Fleurus for many, many years, until, of course, Leo was a lot wronger than me. He said, I will take all the Renoirs, and you keep all the Picassos. I hate that Picasso. I think he ruined the whole story. But I will keep the apples, the Cezanne apples. They are for me. I am sorry. Call it collateral damage.
Did you personally know Henry James?
Henry James. He was the brother. He was the brother. He was the brother who was not sick. The brother who was sick was William. The brother who was not sick was Henry. Henry wrote. Henry wrote a lot. I liked Henry's novels, but mostly Alice B. Toklas liked Henry's novels. Henry James. Maybe Henry James started the stream of consciousness, but maybe I did, because maybe I really streamed in the consciousness. He was just pretending.
Oh yeah, this is the one we had. What is this one? Isn't the Picasso?
But
that?
I did meet Mrs. Agassiz in Harvard. She invited me to tea. Isn't the Picasso head in Chagall's pictures? That's a question for you. Well done.
I've seen some sheep heads in people's
Chagall's Well
walls.
Done.
So we had this about the feet, we had the modern art, the medical school, the Nazis, I already asked you about those.
The Nazis, that's a long question.
That's Did you a have long... help from someone escaping? I don't think you escaped.
I
you
didn't
stayed.
Escape, they told
this
me. The American embassy, the Americans in Lyon told me. They told me in 1940 I should leave. But it was such a fuss to make all those suitcases and leave. And I had already seen one war. It had come and gone. This would come and go. I preferred to stay in my vegetable garden in the south of France. I did get a pass to go see our apartment, though, in Paris for 48 hours, and everything was fine. They never came in. They only came in once, but they didn't take anything out. It was probably my friend, Bernard Fay. He protected me. He cared for me. He always cared for me.
Interesting.
I didn't know about the camps. I died in 1946. I maybe knew in June 1945, Life magazine published some pictures. I may have seen those. I don't know. I don't remember. But I got sick. I got sick and then I died. Did I get sick because of those pictures as well? I don't know. Could it have been? I don't know. I wrote Wars I Have Seen in 1943 and 1944. It was published in 1945, early in 1945. I did not know, but there were those people who went to the work camps. There were those people who went and who said there was no food. They came back and said there was nothing to eat. That's all I know.
Do we have any more questions collected? There's one more question, perhaps. Yes, can we? Oh, there's a direct question here.
How does an artist manage to always be taken care of?
I am one of the few who has always been taken care of.
And Pablo.
Pablo has always been taken care of, too, pretty much, except for in some moments and problems he had, losses he had. He was taken care of. I took care of him. We gave him a stipend, Leo and I. We started giving him a regular salary, basically. Pablo was well taken care of. I was always taken care of. I don't know. Why was I taken care of? I was taken care of because I write, because I wrote, because I wrote. Because I wrote what people wrote, what people thought, what people wanted to be written, because I was doing the doing of writing, the business of writing, I was taken care of. We also took care of ourselves. I ate the Cezanne, I told you that. That beautiful Cezanne, the portrait of his wife, with a fan that Leo and I bought just before meeting Pablo here in 1905. That painting was with me for a long time, many years. I sold that painting in 1943, or was it 44? We ate that painting, Alice B. Toklas and I. We ate that for more than a year.
Had a lot for sure. So I would like to
In the sense that we ate the food that we bought with the money that we sold the painting with. We didn't actually eat the painting. Yes.
Unstoppable, Gertrude. Thank you so very, very much.